Good morning to all, and we welcome you to our online church service today. And to all of those people who are watching this live stream, join us now as we sing praises and thanksgiving to our God. Hallelujah! Indeed, He is good, and His love endures forever. Amen.
Good and your mercy endure forever.
Let's sing, Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endure forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you. Find the way, bring me back to you.
me close.
Draw me close to you.
A happy Sunday to everyone. Thank you so much for joining us in our online worship service. I am Pastor Jovin Lim, the lead pastor of Ictus Dumaguete, and I would like to welcome all our brothers and sisters who are joining us online, and to all our first-time viewers and worshipers today, welcome to Ictus Dumaguete. Now, as we start our message, let's open this with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, God, for all the things that you've done in our lives. We thank you so much for your goodness, for your faithfulness. And Lord, we are here because we want to learn from you. Feed us through your word and let your Holy Spirit be our greatest teacher. Abba Father, we want to worship you. We want to glorify your name in everything we do. That's why today it is our prayer and it is our joy to come before you together as a church and learn from you. Lord, be with us and it's our prayer, it's our joy that whatever lessons and whatever spiritual truth that we can learn today, we can apply it in our daily lives. We bring back all the glory, praises, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. So today, beloved, we will be continuing in our 40 Days of Prayer series. And we are now in our part 6. We are now in our second to the last part of our 40 Days of Prayer Journey. Now, beloved, the title of our message today is How to Pray for Healing and Restoration. So, in this season that we are in right now, we all know that we need healing. Healing from this pandemic, healing from our sickness, healing from our brokenness, or healing from economic or financial crisis. We all need healing. That is why today, we will be talking about how to pray for healing and restoration in this series. About 3,000 years ago, God made a promise to King Solomon, and that promise will stand today because that promise is made for God's people. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 14, it says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land." Let me point out some truth about this verse. This verse talks about a lot of things. And the first thing is, look at the text. Observe carefully. It says, "If my people." This promise is not for everybody. This promise is for God's people. One day, somebody asked Jesus in Matthew chapter 12, verses 46 to 50. While Jesus was teaching the crowd, his mother and brothers waited nearby to speak to him. Someone told Jesus, "Your family wants to talk to you." And Jesus asked, "Who is my family?" Then pointing to his followers, he said, "These people are my family. Anybody who obeys my Father in heaven and does his will is my brother and my sister and my mother." You know, beloved, anyone who obeys the Father by living out his purposes and plans, and whoever does his will is part of God's family. If you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior in your life, you belong to God's family. In John chapter 1, verse 12, it says, "To all who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children of God." Remember that the promise in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, it's not for everybody, but for God's people. The second thing that I want to point out is, look at the next phrase of the text. It says, "who are called by my name." Beloved, have you experienced being embarrassed to identify yourself as a disciple of Jesus? You are embarrassed to say, "I am a disciple of Jesus. I'm a follower of Christ. I'm a Christian." You know, many people today, you are so bold to show what they are passionate about, what they want to stand for, what belief they have, or what hobbies or interests they are in. Many people today are so bold in that part. When they talk to people, when they post something in their social media, they're just so bold. Beloved, let me ask you, what are you so bold about or so passionate with when you talk to other people or post or share something in your social media? Beloved, remember that as God's children, our Father is so passionate about us. He is so bold about us. It says in the next phrase, "who are called by my name." You know, this verse also reminds us to be bold in declaring who God is in our life. You might be asking, how to be bold in living out my God-given purposes? Let me give you some practical tips for this. 5 purposes that we have in worship. Worship God daily through your quiet time and worship God corporately once a week through online or conventional, just like what we are doing together here every Sunday. In fellowship, be bold in connecting with God's people. It's time to engage and identify with God's family. And in discipleship, be bold in growing through a small group discipleship. You can check every Wednesday for the lessons and journey with a small group community. If you are not yet in a D group, we encourage you to be part of one D group. In ministry, you can be bold by being part of a certain ministry or making your everyday as a ministry opportunity to serve God by serving others, especially the ministry of prayer. In missions, you can be bold by sharing to others about God's message of love and hope, especially during this time of crisis and pandemic. Now, I want to share with you a very practical way how to be bold in sharing Christ to your family, friends, and social media. The very first one is for your family or for your friends. Whoever needs prayer, pray for them and pray with them. Just be there. For couples and parents, be bold in discipling your family by initiating family devotions kahit 8 minutes lang. together as a family, read the Bible for 5 minutes, and together as a family, pray for each other's needs and concerns, even for 3 minutes. You can do that as a family, beloved. Secondly, beloved, you can use your social media. You can use it as a ministry platform, your Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and your YouTube channels. Post a verse, post our worship services like this worship service that we have, or our discipleship lesson every Wednesday. Especially during this time, we are talking about prayer. We are disseminating the message of love and hope in Christ Jesus. Now, instead of just posting a 30-second to 1-minute TikTok videos, why not post a 30-second to 1-minute reading or memorizing a Bible promise? It will become a ministry, beloved. You can do that. Now, be bold in every area in your life. You know, Jesus also gave us this reminder in Mark chapter 8, verse 38. If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this faithful and immoral generation, I will be ashamed of him when I return in glory with all my angels. Beloved, again, people need the Lord. People need healing. And God wants you and me to become a channel of blessings for his glory. He wants us to be bold for Jesus. The third thing that I want to point out is 2 Chronicles 7:14, again it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. You know, as God's people, if we will humble before God and we will seek God and we will turn to God, God will hear and forgive and heal the land. Beloved, the point here is, in every promise, there is a premise. Through this verse, we can observe 4 conditions of healing and restoration. Let me ask you this. In what area in your life that you are praying for healing and restoration at this very moment? Are you praying for healing and restoration in your relationship with God? Maybe right now you are carrying a lot of shame and guilt before God. Are you praying for healing and restoration in yourself? Are you full of regrets and blame towards your bad decisions being made in the past? Or are you praying for healing and restoration for your family, for your friends, and other people? Are you praying for healing from your sickness and to have a good health or restoration of your wealth? Again, beloved, I don't know what area in your life that needs restoration, but there are 4 conditions that God is telling us in order to be healed and to be restored according to His Word. Therefore, if you do what He says, He will also do what He promised to you. He will restore you and He will heal you. So, let's get into it. The first condition for healing and restoration in any area in your life is this. Number one, I need to admit I'm not in control. What does it mean, beloved? It means humility. It means telling yourself that God is God and we are not. God is God, I am not. Look at the text again. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. Beloved, humility is the first step to healing. What does it mean for us? When we pray, we don't come to God's presence arrogantly. We don't make demands in our request. We don't argue with Him. The text says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. You can't pray to God saying, oh God, please humble me. You know why? Because humility is a choice. Humility is something that you do and make a choice for yourselves. And the Word of God is calling people to humble themselves. Let me share to you some practical steps how to show humility. 8 ways in showing humility. Number one is this. Humility means confess your sins to God. Beloved, whatever sins you have or you have done, you don't wait for a week, for a month to confess it to God. You confess it to God the moment you realize and the moment the Holy Spirit is convicting you that you sinned against God. Number two, humility means forgive quickly. If you don't know how to forgive quickly and if you carry grudges, that's pride. Humility is about not holding on to a grudge. Humble people forgive quickly. Number 3. When you are treated unfairly, be quiet and be patient and don't retaliate. That's true humility. I am more like Christ when I refuse to defend against false accusations. When people attack you, when people mistreat you, and say things that are not true, you don't say a word. That's true humility. We can see Jesus modeling it for all of us. During his time, he was maligned and accused falsely. He was put on the cross for the things that aren't true. And when Jesus faced the trials, he spoke nothing. What does it say to us, beloved? I am more like Christ when I don't retaliate. Another humility or expression of humility. Number 4, when you look for ways to serve others, not expecting to be served. Another thing is, number 5, when you accept criticism and correction graciously. Number 6, when you intentionally become a friend to people who don't have a status or who can't help you and who are overlooked by society. Number 7, when you speak well of others and you never put down others. And lastly, when you pray for your enemies. Those are the 8 marks of humility. Now the question is, why would anybody live like that? It's hard. Remember this, humility is not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. Beloved, humility is about focusing on God and helping other people. You know why it's important to live a humble life? Because God loves humble people. Let me give you 4 things that God will do in your life if you work on these things. Number 1, if I'm humble, God will surely guide me. Amen? If I'm humble, God will guide me. Beloved, if you don't know where you are going right now, if you are struggling in getting on track with your purposes and plans, the very first key, beloved, is be humble. Psalms 25 verse 9 says, God leads the humble in the right way and teaches them His will. Beloved, do you want to know God's will for your life? God will not give His will to prideful and self-sufficient people. As you humble yourself before God, He will guide you and reveal His will and purposes to you. Let me give you the second benefit. If I'm humble, God will bless me. Isaiah 66 verse 2, it says, I will bless those who have humble and contrite hearts. God doesn't bless ego trippers, prideful people. God blesses those people with humble and contrite heart. Number 3, if I'm humble, God will give me the power to change. Do you know what's the one word of the power to change? It's called grace. It's grace that gives us the power to change. You need grace to make changes in your life. There are things in your life that you really want to change, but you can't. The only way that you can have authentic change in your life is when you understand and receive grace in your life. Now, the question is, how to receive the grace of God in our life to have the power to change? It says in the Bible, James 4:6, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. You will experience God's grace if you know how to humble yourself before God. The more proudful you are, the more you will lose the battle because your arm is too short to box with God. But every time you humble down yourself, you will receive God's grace from above. Number 4, if I'm humble, God will relieve my stress. Do you notice it? When you are humble, your stress goes down. When you are prideful, your stress goes up. In Matthew 11:29, it says, take my yoke I give you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble, and I will restore deep rest to your soul. Now observe the text, beloved. I will restore deep rest to your soul. Now here's the question. Do you need deep rest for your soul? Do you need deep rest for your thoughts? Do you need deep rest in your emotions? Do you need deep rest in your will? Do you keep on going and rushing with tons of pressures every day but running on empty? What does the text says? Jesus says, for I am gentle and humble to restore deep rest of your soul. Therefore, if we humble ourselves to God, He is able to relieve our stresses in life. Now, if you have somebody with you while you are watching this sermon that we have, can you say to that person, starting today, look up, give up, give your stresses to God. Amen? So, I hope that if you have somebody who is watching with us right now, tap the shoulder of that person and say, starting today, look up, give it up, give your stress to the Lord. For sure, He will give you deep rest of your soul. Beloved, always remember that it's about letting go and letting God take charge of your situation. Humility is admitting you are not in control. Now, let's go to the second condition. Number two is, I need to ask God for help. If I need healing and restoration from the Lord, first, I need to admit I'm not in control. It's to humble ourselves before the Lord. Secondly, I need to ask God for help. It says in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14b, it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and, the word here is, pray. This next word reminds us that God is just waiting for us. Do you have something in your life that you want to be healed or to be restored? The question is, have you prayed about it? Are you asking God through prayer that you need help? God is telling you, I will help you if you ask. Now, the truth is this. If you want healing in your sickness, restoration in your marriage, or in your financial crisis, you need to ask God. So how do you pray for healing? Let me give you some tips. How to say to God, Lord, I need you. In John 16, 23 to 24, the Word of God says, I tell you the truth. My Father will give you anything you ask for in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you'll receive so that your joy will be the fullest possible joy. Through these verses, Jesus gives us the first two ways how to ask God for healing and restoration. Here's the first thing you need to do. Remember, Jesus wants me to ask. It says, anything you ask for in my name. The first phrase, anything. Why God wants you to ask anything in prayer? It's because that's the only way you will learn how to trust Him. If you are not asking for anything, you will not learn to trust Him. The second is, it says, ask in Jesus' name. Again, the phrase says, anything you ask for in my name. What does it mean I need to ask in Jesus' name? You might hear a lot of people end their prayers with, in Jesus' name I pray. Or, this all we ask in Jesus' name. And you might also learn them as you pray. But remember that it is not a period. It is not it's not a closing statement. It's not an ending phrase in your prayers. I want to remind you why we pray in Jesus' name. And hopefully, the next time you pray, you will be sincere and confident in ending your prayers with the phrase of affirmation. So, why do we need to pray in Jesus' name? Here's why. Jesus paid everything on the cross. It means Jesus is our confidence that God will answer our prayers. Beloved, when we pray in Jesus' name, God hears us not because of who we are or what we've done, but because of who God is and how much He loves us to the point of giving His one and only Son to die on the cross so that we can have that access in that relationship back to our Heavenly Father. You know, the next time you pray in Jesus' name, remember the cross. The cross is our confidence that God hears and answers our prayers. Now, here's a question. Why is it that we don't receive everything we prayed for? What is the problem of that verse? Now, let's take a closer look of this verse. This verse doesn't say, I will give you everything. But Jesus says, you can ask for anything. You can pray for anything. Meaning, you can pray to God about anything, but it is God who will determine if what you are asking for is for your good or not. It means He has the authority and the power to answer it with yes, no, or wait. It must be according to His plan. Beloved, the third one on how to pray for healing is found in James chapter 5, verse 13. Is anyone of you in trouble? He should pray. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Is anyone of you sick? He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. What does this verses talks about? The third tip, beloved, is this. Get other people to pray with you. As the text says, he should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. What does this simply mean? We need to get people, our brothers and sisters, to intercede with us. You might be asking right now how to do that. How to get other people pray for my concern. Let me give you three practical tips. Number one, list names of people who can commit to pray for you. Number two, ask them to commit to pray for you. If you have some prayer concerns, you can call, you can text, you can chat them. And thirdly, commit also to pray for them. It's a win-win, beloved. I myself know that I have at least 143 people in my list who are ready and always praying for me. And if every time I have some concerns and prayer requests for the church and for my personal life, I know that I can count them and I can share to them by texting or by calling. And I believe that they will be praying for me. Beloved, in Matthew 18:19, it says, I tell you that if just two of you on earth agree together about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. So beloved, through this verse, even if you just have even one person to pray for you and with you, God will hear it. Now, if there are things in your life that you need to be prayed for, but it's too personal, but you want somebody to pray for you and with you, why not just share it to your husband or to your wife if you have, or your discipler, your accountability partner, your best friend, your close friend, and be prayed over. Remember this for the couples. It is God's design for all of us that our spouse is our number one prayer partner who will pray for us and pray with us. Amen? So shout out to all couples. Now, let me ask you this to the couples. When was the last time that you've done a heart-to-heart talk with your spouse about the personal struggles you are facing? Not about work, not about business, not about other people, but your personal life. When was the last time? You know, nowadays, one of the reasons why relationships are becoming weak, especially for the couples, because of the lack of the two communication. Communication to each other and their communication to God as a couple. We need to strengthen it together. Again, beloved, get other people to pray with you. If you're single, if you're in a D group, if you're in a ministry, if you're in a church, ask anyone from God's family to pray with you and for you. Tip number four, believe and expect an answer. It says in our verse, and the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. It simply means your prayers will be answered by God. Remember, beloved, that it's God who will answer and our part is to ask. So again, if you need healing and restoration in some areas in your life, the first thing that you need to do is, I need to admit I'm not in control. The second one, I need to ask God for help. Now, let's go to the third premise for the promise. Seek God, not the miracle. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. You know, this reminds us that when we pray, it's not the answer or miracles or signs or healing that we are seeking, but we are seeking the God that we believe in. That's one of the common mistakes why people, when they pray, they didn't get the answer to their prayers because they seek the wrong thing. What this verse reminds us is that whether we get a yes to our prayers or not, we long to seek God even more. That's maturity, beloved. When you seek the right thing, to seek God above anything else. In Proverbs chapter 8, verse 17, it says, I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me. Also in Hebrews 11, 6, it says, God rewards those who earnestly seek Him. And in Psalms 14, verse 2, the Lord looks down from heaven on the entire human race. He looks to see if there's even one with real understanding, one who seeks for God. Beloved, God is looking unto us. If we are sincere and committed to seek Him other than just answering our prayers and blessing us, He wants to have an intimate relationship with us more than anything else. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 29 to 31a, it says, If you seek the Lord, you will find Him. If you will look for Him with all your heart and with all your soul. When you are in distress and all these things have happened to you, you will return to the Lord your God and obey Him. For He is a merciful God. He will not abandon or destroy you. Now, if you're living a life in a cycle year after year and you don't get any better in any situation, you might get stuck because you are not seeking God. So what to do? There are actually three things that we can find in this verse. Number one, we need to seek God with all your heart. Number two, you need to return with a repentant heart. And number three, obey by trusting with all your heart. Beloved, if you do that, you will find God and you will experience Him. You can experience His healing and you can experience Jesus is restoring you. All you need to do is to seek, you need to return, and you need to obey. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, it says, Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all the other things will be given to you as well. There is nothing that God will not do for the man or woman that takes joy in seeking God above anything else. In other side, God will look at it. He may say, people are looking for blessings from me, healing from me, favor from me, provision from me, but not all people are really seeking me. So how to seek God through your prayer? Go back to our last Sunday's message, how to pray to God throughout your day. Review it, apply it, and evaluate yourself. How are you doing that? Beloved, let me ask you, how are you in applying it last week? How are you in seeking God? Are you enjoying it? Keep doing it, beloved, for God will show breakthroughs in your prayer. Now, let's go to the last and fourth premise. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, it says, If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Number four, beloved, is I need to turn my attention from the world to the Word. There are two words that we really need to understand in this point. The word turn and the word wicked. So let's start with wicked. When I say wicked, what do you think of? Many people would think about that word as people who do really bad or evil stuff to people, like killing, like rape, like abuse, and any other bad things. But today, let me give you a definition of wicked in what the Bible is telling us. Wickedness is forgetting God. It means anytime that I forget God, it's wickedness. Because He loves you, He wants you to enjoy every area and every moment of your life, but He doesn't want you to forget Him. Wickedness is when we forget God. Beloved, let me ask you, in what area in your life that you have the tendency to forget God? Is it in your time? Is He always at the last and we are full of personal agenda? Is it in your money or how you manage the financial blessings? Is He always at the surplus? Is it about your relationship? Were purity and authentic love being abandoned? Beloved, when you forget God, you do a lot of different crazy, destructive stuff. And the world can offer you a lot of appealing and desirable yet destructible things that you can get attached to. It's like a ticking time bomb. It will not blow for now, but soon it will destroy you. Isaiah 17:10, it says, You have forgotten the God who saves you. and you have not remembered that God is your place of safety. Beloved, do you know why sometimes we dwell in what's being offered in this world? Because we are searching for stability. We are searching for security. And we are searching for safety. But you know what? God is simply telling all of us that He is our safety. Beloved, let me ask you, where do you put your safety and stability? Your security in life? Is it in your bank account? Is it in your relationship? In your ability? In your business? In your career? In your material possessions? Or you put your safety to our Abba Father in heaven? I hope that during this time of pandemic, this become a personal decision for you, especially where to put your safety. There is no other safe place than to be in God's presence. And in order to be in God's presence, we need to follow His will and submit to His power to work within our life. Now, let's talk about the word turn. What about the word turn? It means to return, bring back, and it means to repent. Turn means metanoia. It means renewal of mind. It means you change your mindset and your action will just follow. That's what we call repentance. When you change your mind about life, about success, about what matters most, about past and future, about love, that is repentance, beloved. When we turn our attention from the world to God's word. Beloved, don't think about repentance as a negative word. Like those people who walk on the streets and bring a placard, no? A statement, turn or burn, you're gonna die or fry or go to the sky. That's not the kind of repentance we're talking about. The kind of repentance that we're talking here is not a negative word. It is the most positive word throughout history. When I choose to repent, I turn my guilt into forgiveness. I turn my darkness to light. I turn from no purpose to purpose-driven. I turn from my hopeless despair to hope for eternity. I turn from bitterness to love. It was the most positive word in our life. If we just have known how positive it is to repent, we would have done it years earlier. Acts chapter 3 verse 19, it says, "Repent and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, so that times of refreshing may come from the Lord." Beloved, do you need a time of refreshing in your life right now? Proverbs 28:13 says, "If you hide your sins, you will not succeed. But if you confess and reject them, you will receive mercy." If you keep holding on, beloved, onto sin, you will surely get stuck. But if you confess and reject them, you will receive mercy and find healing and restoration. So today, before I'll close, let's have a summary of what we learned today. If I want to pray for healing and restoration, what to do? Four things. I need to admit I'm not in control. Number two, I need to ask God for help. Number three, I need to seek God, not the miracle. And number four, I need to turn my attention from the world to the Word. Now, there are three things that God promised when we do these four things. What are those? Look at the text again. 2 Chronicles 7:14. "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land." So, beloved, there are three things that God promised to do. Number one, God will hear. Two, God will forgive. And third, God will heal our land. So, beloved, before I will end in a word of prayer, let's reflect upon the message today. As we have our response song, I want you to ask yourself and talk to the Lord, or maybe listen to God for what He will be telling you. There are four points that we learn about how to pray for healing and restoration. And I want to ask you this. In what area in your life that you need healing or restoration? And what God is telling you right now? Is God calling you to admit that you are not in control, that He is in charge? Is God calling you to ask for help from Him? Or is God telling you to really seek God Not for the signs, not for the answers to your prayers, not for a miracle, but seek God with all your heart. Or is God telling you to turn your attention to His Word and not from whatever is in this world? Beloved, if you are really serious about praying for healing and restoration, it's really my prayer that you will seek Him, that you will turn from your wicked ways, and obey His process. Trust His process, beloved, for He's a good, good Father, and for sure, you will end up victorious in whatever you are facing right now. So therefore, do you really want these wonderful promises that God is giving us? Do you really want God that will hear you? Do you really want to experience God's forgiveness, cleansing of all the guilt and shame in your life? Do you want to experience the healing of our land, in our nation, in your community, or probably in your own family? Beloved, trust God, repent, and seek Him. And it's my prayer for you and me today that we will continue to grow stronger as we pray for whatever situation in our life, in our heart, that needs healing and restoration. May God's healing be upon you, and may God's restoration build you up again by His grace and mercy and love. So again, as we listen to this response song, let's ponder for a moment. If there's any thanksgiving, if there's any confession of sin that you need to make, if there's any recommitment that you need to make today, my prayer for you is that you will humble yourself before the Lord. Let's have a time now to pray, listen to the Lord, and reflect upon His goodness as we have this response song. And after this, I will have my final challenge, and I will close in a word of prayer.
I don't need a rainbow to know who made the rain. To be the water spotted to know who made a way. I don't need a healing to know what is the cure of this, I'm sure. I believe that there is something more than I can see. I believe that there is someone holding on to me. Sometimes I don't feel it, but that don't change a thing. 'Cause it's by faith that I believe. Oh, 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 oh. If you had some heartache, made you cry a thousand tears, let me tell you now, I know just how you feel. That heavy weight of sorrow that you've carried for so long will soon be gone. I believe that there is something more than I can see. I believe that there is someone holding on to me. Sometimes I don't feel it, but that don't change a thing. 'Cause it's by faith and I believe. You might see a miracle and give praises to the Lord. Don't let them touch from heaven, be the thing you're waiting for. Blessed are those who have seen but still believe. Do you believe? Oh, I believe that there is something more than I can see. I believe that the arms of Jesus holding on to me. Sometimes I don't feel it, but that don't change a thing. 'Cause it's by faith that I believe. Oh, oh, oh.
Praise God for that beautiful song as a response to the message today. Beloved, before I will end in a word of prayer, let me give you a challenge for this week. Number one is, try to recall. Is there anything that hinders between you and the Lord? Is there anything in your heart right now? You need to pray about it. You need to ask God about this. Is there anything in your life that needs healing and restoration between you and the Lord? Throughout the week, you pray about it. You ponder about it. Number two, ask the Lord and pray. Is there anything right now that needs healing and restoration in your relationship with yourself? Maybe because of strong regret, blame, and any other thing. And number three, ask yourself and evaluate. Is there any area in my relationship with other people that needs healing and restoration? If you spotted some areas in your life, I want to encourage you to lift it up to the Lord in prayer. And if you think it's just so heavy right now, always remember that we are just here for you as a family. We can help you. We can pray for you. You might need special prayer. You might need special counseling. We are just here for you. If you feel that you need it, please don't wait, but text us, chat us, or call us, because we want to help you. Even we can just meet online by Skype, Zoom, or any other communications that we can have. Beloved, God wants you to be released. God wants you to be healed. God wants to break the shackles that putting you down, that you are stuck in your life. He wants you to live out His purposes, His will, and His plans. That is why today, God is telling you, release it, look up, give it up to God, so that you can continue to live for Him. Amen? Now, let's end this with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful message that you have given us. Abba, thank you for the affirmation that you never leave us, you never forsake us. And thank you for your message that give us hope and encouragement that yes, we can experience healing. We can experience breakthrough because you are our God. You are our Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. You can heal, you can restore any brokenness in our life from our relationship with the Lord, from our relationship to ourselves and to other people. And we pray, Abba Father, that now we learn how to have the steps and to bring healing and restoration in our personal life. It's our prayer that you will work in our life, have your way, let your grace, mercy, and love continue to overflow in our lives. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying for my sins on that cross. And thank you so much for your love and the salvation you have given me. And Holy Spirit, as I continue to live day by day, help me to glorify the Lord in everything I do. May your love, may your joy, and may your peace will continue to cover us as we continue to live for your glory, Abba Father. Salamat kaayo Ginoo, and this is all we ask. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Thank you so much, beloved, for joining us today. I hope that all of us are refreshed, renewed, and challenged. Now, before we will have our closing song, let's stay for a moment for some announcements.
Hello, church. Please take a moment for these announcements. Worship with us every Sunday at 11 via our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Join us online every Wednesday. Our midweek worship service starts at 7 p.m. via our Facebook page and YouTube channel. If you have prayer concerns, please let us know by sending our Facebook page a message. Discover your God-given purpose in God's family. Be part of our LAP 101 class. For more information, kindly contact 0917187-3183 or message us in Facebook. Our discipleship groups never stops. Be part of AD group now. Contact 0917187-3183 or message us in Facebook. Worship through giving. You can now give your tithes and offerings online. Use your BPI mobile app to scan through the QR code or visit our website, ichthisdoomitgetia.org, for more info. You can also give via PayPal. Scan through the QR code or visit our website for more info. We thank you for worshiping with us. Have a great day.
Indeed, He is good, and His love endures forever. Amen.
Good and your mercy endure forever.
Let's sing, Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endure forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Your mercy endureth forever.